I swear I'll be a millionaire. Trouble with money, baby. I swear I'll be a millionaire.
I guess that. Alrighty, we're having a little, and of all people, this is my favorite blues guitarist of all time, B.B. King as well. This is Albert Collins with "If Trouble Was Money." You really have to listen to it. It's a fantastic song, but more so about his musicianship. Incredible. It's from his 1993 compilation album, Collins Mix, The Best of Albert Collins. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid. And we keep moving along. Well, lots to talk about, but I don't know if we will get through this because it's so much. I did say yesterday that if you have something to add to yesterday's discussion, we will allow some time for that, but we have so much to move on with today. So call immediately at 888-874-4888 if there is something pressing that you wish to add to yesterday's discussion. All right? We'll take one or two questions and move on because we want to catch up. So I'll wait and see if there are any calls coming in with regard to yesterday's discussion. And then we will move ahead. Okay. No calls so far. So let's move ahead. Well, the court has ruled today that President Trump must release his financial statements and information to the committee, the Congressional Committee, looking into his finances and his banking practices, his own banking practices. So that serves one huge wallop against President Trump. As you know, this is something he has been fighting for a long time, obviously because there's much to learn about his business practices and whether they conform with U.S. law. The financial information had been requested by the committee and several members of the committee who are looking into Trump's finances and had requested them. He right off the bat said, no way you're going to get this. And they countered with subpoenas. And the court, the federal court today, ruled that it is perfectly legal what the committee is asking for, and he must give it up. They only cautioned that they should not release private information, confidential private information, or you could say personal information, as they release these records. But the court made it very clear that there was nothing untoward about the request. There was nothing untoward about subpoenas because he had been resisting all along, and his arguments were specious. So now it is clear that is what he has to do. They also approved. They said that it was quite all right as well to ask for the financial records of his adult children. So that's a big one. That's a big one to deal with today. The House is releasing today a report on Trump's alleged wrongdoings with regard to Ukraine, which is one thing. Here's what I find fascinating. Even before the release of the report, the Republicans already have released their own 123-page rebuttal to the report. Now, how does that work? The Democrats are releasing what they believe to be a first-hand report today. The Republicans have already released a rebuttal. Tells you something about the confidentiality of things in the Congress. So I thought that was very fascinating. Let's see my notes. We have some interesting developments. And we have to keep track of these things. Yesterday, as we talked about many candidates who had announced that they would be running, just fell off the radar screen. They cannot continue either because they don't meet the requirements, the party's requirements for continuing an affiliation with the party, or they basically they have come to different conclusions based on reality smacking them in the face. I'm afraid to say that Cory Booker seems to be in trouble. Cory Booker, the senator from New Jersey, from Newark. He seems to be fighting for his life in this presidential race. He seems to be teetering on the brink. Money woes, meaning he doesn't seem to have a good financial cushion to support him. And that is one of the major reasons that candidates don't continue with their candidacies. They have no money. And that further speaks to planning. It's becoming so clear that one of the things that must be done, this must happen, and I think it ought to be a bipartisan effort, but at the very least, in the interests of so many candidates who fall off the radar screen because of things like this that seem to crop up. Well, how could they seem to crop up? You know you want to run. You've declared you're going to run. You're priming the pump to run. You have people expecting that you will run. And then right on the brink of pressing the go button, we have things that torpedo the chances that you would run. And one of them is shortage of money. Now, I'm not trying to beat up anybody. I really am not. But it seems to me, if those are your ambitions, And you have, I mean, he's not a newbie. He's not a neophyte. He knows what is required to run a reasonably bulletproof race. You got to have your resources. You have to have resources beyond the initial amount of money it would take to, you know, hold news conference saying, I'm running. You have to have a war chest. There's a target on your forehead and in the middle of your back. You can't be lackadaisical about this. So if you think you will be interested in running in any particular cycle, you gear your fundraising efforts accordingly. You should have started fundraising like 2 or 3 years ago, quietly, but you stash your cash, okay? You're ready. And certainly nothing like, you know, a shortage of cash should torpedo your effort. So the idea that I have had for a long time is somebody should establish an institute or some kind of a consulting practice. Well, I'm sure there are consulting practices that advise people how to run for office. But this we've run into this dilemma too many times. Too many good candidates or promising candidates are torpedoed by lack of cash. So this is where Cory Booker is. He's a young man. He has ambitions. There are other issues that he has to deal with. But money is a fundamental issue. You cannot get away from it if you're running for office. And if, in fact, you're running for office and you run out of money, shame on you. Shame on you. Also, shame on the community that allegedly supports you. People don't understand that that is an obligation. It becomes an obligation. If you feel very solid with a candidate, you have to try your very best to make a contribution, a financial contribution, to keep the campaign going. But for some reason, especially in African-American communities and Latino communities, people are hesitant to do that. And they think it is acceptable simply to brush it off and say, well, you know, times are hard. Times are hard for everybody. But if you really understand what the candidate is trying to do, if you really want to support a candidate or a radio station like, for example, PRN, we should not have to conduct special campaigns to ask people to support something that supports them every day. That should be one of the benchmarks of your political commitment and understanding. It's the same in politics. It's the same with anything where a person or a group is doing the work, committed to doing the work. They have unique pressures on them that they're dealing with. And then the talk is, well, you know, they have unique pressures that they're dealing with. It doesn't solve anything. You contribute, you support, you make that support tangible. So people are watching the Booker campaign very carefully, but watching it does not help. Supporting it, if you are inclined to support Cory Booker, then quit the talking and start with the giving. Start with the support that he needs to continue. Well, that is very, very, very important. By contrast, you take Andrew Yang. All right. This young brother out there turning things upside down. His last fundraising numbers showed that even though he was and is still being ignored by the media, he's not getting his message out. They have isolated him. He raised $25 million. Now that's a statement. People see the potential he brings to helping deal with the problems that as a community they're having today and will continue to have. Like I said, he has not been respected by the media. He hasn't gotten a fair treatment. He hasn't gotten any kind of treatment except casual notice. And yet his community said, oh, really? Here's what we think. Here's $25 million worth of what we think. That's when a community is serious. And that's when a candidate is rooted in a community. That is phenomenal. Phenomenal. And this is a neophyte. He hasn't been in politics ever. He's a businessman operating a small to medium-sized business. But the point I'm making is when people understand a candidate and what the candidate's vision is, and when that candidate is connected to the community, and people accept it as genuine. He's not fooling around. He's not wasting time. He's not posturing. He's genuinely interested in helping a community. They will respond. No other candidate, by the way, so far in this race, has had that kind of response. Millionaire or billionaire or what? And it is sad to me, it's very sad, that we don't embrace the potential of candidates who are genuine about serving their community. I'm not saying, getting all kind of syrupy here. But these are the things people would know if they're taught. And for particular communities, especially the African American and Latino communities, communities of color across the board, they haven't been properly schooled. This is important. They haven't been properly taught by people with a genuine interest in making an investment in these besieged communities. That investment would be creating incredible, capable leadership. So we end up today. He's been a senator already. He's still there in Congress. But could you imagine how disheartening it is, or it will be, if Cory Booker cannot excite his own community. Enough to make a small investment in a big idea. So that's where he is at the moment. And he has to make a decision soon, because we have the December 12th date looming over his head. What is that date? It's about meeting the deadline and the requirements of the party to participate in these so-called debates, which we've called the show and tells, but they're important. He would be written off instantly if he's not, you know, in the herd. He wouldn't have a fighting chance as a Democratic candidate. And yet, Newark is New Jersey's largest city. If they're not going to stand up, and as I said, it's not whether I believe he, you know, he. I'm not endorsing anybody. I'm making the case that it reflects poorly, and the communities don't seem to get that. They want everything, fine, but they support nothing, or next to nothing. There are people who call in to this program and they wax philosophic and they have very, very strong ideas and, you know, great. This is wonderful. But that's what the station provides. That's what I provide. That's what listeners provide. What do you provide? Besides a strong opinion, how do you ensure that the very vehicle that gives you a platform to speak your mind continues to survive? And it really doesn't take much. This is the lesson we have learned time and again in the political arena. We have a race of great significance, no matter how they try to tamp it down, make it look as if, well, you know, it's moving along. No, there's a fight going on, whether you choose to recognize it or not. And it will have far-reaching repercussions. You have to react one way or the other, however best you can make your contribution. So I speak of Cory Booker with a great deal of concern, not for Cory Booker's sake, but also, I mean, you can't ignore that, yes, it's a political race, but I'm sure he could find other ways to earn a living. I'm sure there are other things he could do, but he chose this. And it appears to me that he's not sufficiently prepared. The same with Kamala Harris. What are you doing saying you're running for president? You are completely ill-prepared. And there's nothing more irritating than blowing a great opportunity because you haven't taken the time. You haven't assembled your soldiers right. You don't have a cogent plan, and you certainly don't have money. So why are you trying to kid people and tell them, you know, yeah, I'm running. You're running for what? You can't even run to the supermarket with that kind of argument. That's not persuasive. That's not impressive. And it continues to spoil, and this is a very important aspect of black politics, if you will. The more people fail, the more we have, or you manufacture credible arguments that you can't handle it. The more you fail, the more it appears that you don't have your ducks in a row. In fact, you don't even have ducks to put in a row. And you're out there, you know, parading as if you're a serious candidate. I talked about the mayor of Miramar, who announced at the last so-called debate that he was dropping out of the presidential race. Okay. The general consensus was that he was a nice fellow. He was an athlete, a football player, and well known in Miramar. Well, after all, he's mayor. Okay. But at the time of his exit, he had $5. This is reported. He had $5 in his war chest. Really? Whose idea was it to legitimize such a person, saying that he actually is a candidate for anything, for dog catcher? He should not be permitted in the race. I know people are going to say all kinds of things. It's a free country. Everybody can run. Well, you run and embarrass yourself only. If I were some kind of official with the Democratic Party, I certainly would want to look at the candidates and make a judgment. I think there ought to be a committee that goes through the list of candidates who are running. You have $5. You can't even play bid whist with that. Nobody should take you seriously. Nobody. So that's what's going on with the candidates. We have the December 12th date. You wonder what's going on in their heads. What could possibly be going on in your head to make you believe that you are a viable candidate? And then to insist that others regard you as such. You're a joke. A sick joke. But I come back to the point of we really need to see established, and it doesn't need to be big and public and whatnot. We need serious people gathering together and establishing what in effect would be a university of politics. If that's what you want to do, let's establish something that teaches people how to do it. Sets up some criteria and start something in the direction of education, because as we see time and again, we sorely need it. So I have a lot of notes here, and that's boring. So let's get into conversation. And Patricia, luckily, is with us from Manhattan. Hello, Patricia.
Good afternoon, Eutrice, and good afternoon to the PRN family. About 2 minutes after you got on the air, Kamala Harris announced that she's dropping out of the race.
What did I say?
Yes, you did. Yes, you did. Okay. And I'll tell you something. What she cited was money, that she was not able to raise the requisite money for her to be included in the next debate. But, you know, I think she had a much deeper problem than that. And I think that's the issue with Cory Booker. Because those of us here in the Northeast have some understanding of who Cory Booker is. He's not the person that he portrays himself to be. He has very little connection to the black community. And, you know, that's always the barometer. You have to be authentic. You have to be genuine. You can't be Johnny Come Lately and say, here I am, I'm black, so I'm your candidate. You have to have first established a relationship with the community that extends, that is extensive, that didn't happen yesterday or last month or last year. And I don't get a sense that Cory Booker clearly does not have that. He may live in the community, but I can tell you he has been in New York politics back when Bloomberg was mayor. He was one of those who supported Bloomberg's third term and how he went about getting that third term. And he and I had we were at a function once, and I asked him about that, and we disagreed, and he said, well, you know, we're going to agree to disagree. He was polite, but it was clear that he was dismissive of my issue, of my argument, and from that day on, I never had another nice thing to say about Cory Booker. Well, the same thing happened with Kamala Harris. She was in New York December. She was in New York in October. And I went to a fundraiser because I wanted to see if I could get a one-on-one with her. And guess what? I did. And I raised an issue that is of concern to me, and that is aggressive policing in our community. And she turned to her legislative aide and said, take my contact information, and they would be in contact with me. I'm still waiting. So you see, you've got to be genuine. You've got to be authentic. Just don't talk the talk to make black folks think that, you know, I am your ticket. I am the only game in town. No. So that's the issue with Cory Booker and Kamala Harris. They're not authentic. They're not genuine. And guess what? The community knows it.
Exactly. I'm all the way in Florida. I've never met Kamala Harris. I've met Cory Booker. But you are right on point about how they'll come across, which is, to me, this is a basic rule of politics. If you're running for any kind of office, there's some basic things you ought to know and do. It is not impressing anybody that you're trying to tell everybody how middle class, an upper middle class you are. What does that do for you? And yet you can see that with candidates who understand politics, literally as a person-to-person contact thing, this is what Powell had, that few of our leaders today have. You gotta establish some kind of rapport, whether you speak it or whether you show it. But no, I did say that. You know, I've been reviewing some of my political programs, and I'm amazed at myself for saying, well, this is where this is going. This is how this will end. Because you can see it. And for the life of me, I can't understand why nobody saw Kamala Harris's demise coming.
Well, I did. One of our local politicians here, with whom I have a connection, was at that same fundraiser back in October. And he and I got into a debate about Kamala. And he was telling me about all the reasons why. But I said to him, look, your support for her is based on the fact that she's black. That's not enough. Because look how many black politicians we have who disappoint us every minute of every day. You got to do more than that. You got to show up. And none of these folks have shown up. And the community knows they haven't shown up. The only person who doesn't understand that they haven't shown up is them. They figure all they got to do is show up now, and we will take them lock, stock, and barrel.
Sure. Suddenly, it's an us and them fight.
There you go.
You're one of them.
That's
You're
the other
also
issue that I
said
them. With him, was that she had no plan. You know, people laugh at Elizabeth Warren when she says, I have a plan. Well, her strategy was just to criticize everybody else, but she had no plan for anything.
But it was visible from day one.
It was
visible from day one, because that's what I continue to carp about. What exactly is your purpose or reason for being in a presidential race? Other than, you know, your own sense of self-ambition and so forth. But what is the advantage to the community, to the country as a whole, that you are a candidate in this presidential race? It's nothing. Remember that night with the debate, the so-called debate, where I said, if you're paying attention, she had nothing to offer. And what she decided to do was to direct attention away from the fact that she had nothing to show.
Exactly.
As a national benefit. And she had to reach all the way back to when she was a little girl riding on the bus. Ms. Harris, you do know that it's 2019, right? So could you bring us closer in your history, closer to the moment? She couldn't do that. She just thought that everybody would recognize, especially that sector of the community, who they take great pride in people who visibly show some of the things they want back in life. Cory Booker too, nice young man, suitable complexion, from a good home, and so forth. That has nothing to do with politics. Look who is in the White House and tell me that these things matter. These standards. In fact, the fewer standards you have, the better the shot you have with this president. Thanks, Patricia, for calling in.
Have a good day.
You too. 888-874-4888. Things are progressing, and do not lose sight of the historic challenges this country faces internally. And we're seeing how racially bifurcated America really is. Different sets of standards, different sets of expectations, different results. All of this is still going along. Nobody's talking about these things, but they're part and parcel of what we are experiencing as a nation. Our attitudes are shaped by this history, and the history is current. Don't let anybody fool you that, well, you know, we have these progressives and even radicals running for various offices. When you inspect their actions, you find a night and day difference between what they say and what they do. And you find very quickly that you would be correct to question the confluence between the two. There very often is not. A lot of people talking about, you know, how revolutionary they are. They're just talking. They're not prepared to prove what their so-called beliefs are, but they say things to impress people, and people are easily impressed. We have such a case with Ilhan Omar. So we're looking at things, and we're seeing a lack of continuity between what is said and what is actually done. 888-874-4888. I have a question that has not been answered yet. Well, I'm not going to talk about Trump today, except that, you know, he got a walloping today. Let's see. Mayor Ross Baraka of Newark has sued Mayor de Blasio and the de Blasio administration for a program that Mayor de Blasio has been running that Mayor Baraka says is patently unfair. And that program is to provide a one-time only cash incentive to encourage people, especially those who are poor, and this is specifically targeted to people who are poor, to encourage them to get out of New York City and go next door across the river to Newark, New Jersey, and find themselves a home there. And the idea is that that's a practical way to solve the problem of homelessness. But Ras Baraka, the Mayor Baraka of Newark, has some questions about that. We'll get to that, but think about it first. David from Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Good afternoon, Yatrice.
Hello, how are you?
I'm getting along. Look, I've been listening, and I'm going to tell you what's coming across my mind. No matter what people say who are running in this rigged operation by these two groups in the Uniparty, one thing people have to remember, and that one thing is that the United States is an empire, and those people who run the empire and also run those two groups within the Uniparty, Republican and Democrat, control those two parties. And no matter what is said by these so-called candidates to be the manager of this empire, the people who run it do not want any change whatsoever. They want to continue in power. These so-called elections are always rigged. The parties involved and those in the various legislative branches, the judiciary branch and the executive branch, everything is rigged against the people. People have to remember that a handful of people own most of the economy in this country. They own most of the wealth. And a fraction of the wealth is owned by the majority of the people. So we don't have a democracy at all. Why, if we had a democracy, why would people decide to be poor, like maybe half the people are poor in this country? So this, I might call it a circus that's going on with the candidates and whatnot. Those people who are even saying some progressive things know full well that's what you give to the people who you keep confused about what you're going to do in their favor. But if you do get in there, they know who the boss is. The boss is the ruling class at the top who run things in the country, run those two parties in that uniparty. And they don't want anything to change. They want to maintain empire and absolute control as they do now. These people in the legislative branch, we might say, they're in there, but they don't do what is good for the people. They do what is good for the ruling class. So we can have all kinds of conversations about these people raising money, and that's all a corrupt operation, because the money is raised mostly by the ruling class, who control the purse strings, and every candidate that is up there knows full well that those who rule don't want any progressive thing that is done for the people and change the nature of the system that is designed to enrich the few at the expense of the many. And that's getting worse and worse every day, and people don't get it. They don't get it because those who rule are very successful in the operation called divide and conquer. And that's working. That's working for them well. It's pathetic. It's so sad to listen to how they want to keep the masses of people ignorant. That is the way that they can maintain their rule and their wealth and increase their wealth. That's the only thing they're concerned with, increasing the capitalist wealth that they're making, and they don't care anything about the people, and people have to get it, and a lot of folks don't. So I don't waste my time thinking about Republican and Democrat, and that's the way I feel.
All right. Let me ask you, what should the alternative be to that?
Well, the only alternative that will have any meaningful change is rebellion by the people. That's the only way you're going to get some change. And as I have said before, the people usually fall for the okey-doke, because the ruling class has successfully worked out a way to blunt any real rebellion by throwing out the proverbial bones, and at the right time, taking the bones back. So people have to get that. The system is not made. Why would someone who is running a system like this want to give up anything? That's impossible. The Republican and the so-called Democrat Party, they're controlled by those who rule. They don't do what the people want. They might say so in one of these pseudo elections that they have, but the point is they're in the same party together, and their goal is to maintain empire right here in this country and all around the world, everywhere in the world that they can do it. And, you know, that's the thing I think people have to remember.
So, if that is the case, do we continue with the electoral process, or is there something else?
This uniparty. I mean, you know, it saddens me to see people who are being rigged, punished by this uniparty, have such allegiance to their enemy. You see little poor people, a lot of poor little white people, you know, glorifying Mr. Trump. I mean, that's so sad to see. You see black people, they think that, the Democratic Party is, the thing is great, you know, and, I'm a big Democrat and whatnot. And they don't understand that party, just like the other one, the Republican, are controlled by ruling class people who operated in ruling class interests. So they can trot out some candidates, said something progressive, but it didn't mean anything. Because that's just pre-election talk, and they know full well that these two groups take turns in legislative branch, and that's the way it goes. These parties are never going to operate in the interest of the people who live here. And if people understood that that's the way it is, I think things would be different. People don't decide to be poor, and you know, if the country was run in the interest of the people, you wouldn't have the poverty and the social conditions that are against the people, no matter what color they are. You wouldn't have the situation of divide and conquer, with dividing people up and conquering them by having them oppress, opposing each other. And that's what we're doing over here. That's on overdrive here, because the ruling class is just laughing. And, you know, it's so sad to see that most people haven't got a clue. They don't get it, you know, and I don't know what one can do to get it across, because it's very hard, because those who rule, they control all the media. They control the schools. They tell the children lies at all level of education. That's what they do. And it seems to work very well to keep the status quo in effect. And that's the sad thing, that people have no understanding of how this system works. They don't know anything about history, because those who rule wouldn't want you to know about the history, the history of the United States. They give you propaganda. That's what's in the history books in these schools. So, you know, it's a very sad thing, and we've got to get to the point where people start educating themselves rather than being trained, and people have to do what is necessary to get beyond the onslaught by that small ruling class who runs this country and most of the world.
Thank you very much, David, for your thoughtful presentation today. I greatly appreciate it. Well, we are in the moment, just the same. And along with what is happening, which is presented to us as the reality of our joint situation, we still do recognize that a lot of it is not of our making or under our control. So that's the perpetual question. How do we construct, or should we even construct, an alternative that does not resemble the situation that we've been dealing with for hundreds of years? How do we get out of this bind? And that's what I mean by the fact that when we observe a national presidential contest, okay, and it's been going on for a long, long time, this idea of electing people to represent us, which is a part of the whole concept of democracy, democratic rule. But we are, as David just pointed out, and I agree with that, we are more often victims of it. We are not necessarily helped by it, because it does not necessarily see us as the primary beneficiaries of this concept, that everybody should have some kind of access to the throttle and brake of government. It just has not occurred in this society ever. That if we say, as a nation of voters, no, then that thing that we object to should not go forward, but it does. You see? So we come down all the time to what is this relationship between the people and the apparatus of government? Do we control it in some way, some meaningful way, or does it always control us? It is the boss. And within that, we have people doing their own thing to participate very often in this kind of, it's a sad thing, but it is true. They're playing their role, their appointed role, in the continuation of exploitation of the people. And that has to come to a head at some point. But we have to take ownership of this very process. How do we become self-governing, or seriously self-governing? Can it happen? What has to happen to make that so? Thanks so much for listening today, and let's join each other again tomorrow. I really appreciate your comments and your thoughts. Very enlightening. Bye-bye.